You're watching the free version of Silhouette Essentials. For projects and footage, head to borisfx.com for the premium download.
Welcome to this first class in the Silhouette Paint Essentials course. My name is Katie Morris and I will be your instructor. This class is called Quick Start Intro, where it will be exactly that. How to learn a little bit about the Silhouette interface and get set up for a painting project. You can see here that I have launched the application and the interface looks a little bit different than previous versions as the splash screen with the project options no longer comes up. For this course, I'll be using Silhouette version 2023.5.4. At the top of the viewer, you can see that it says Unnamed Project. From here, there are several options. I like to immediately save my project file, so let's do that. And we'll press Save. Next, we need to import some footage, and there are four ways to do that. You can go to File, Import Media, or you can click on this icon in the lower left corner of the Sources window, and you can import your footage that way. You can double-click inside the Sources window, and it brings up the window where you can select your footage. We'll cancel that, and there's one last way, is where you can drag and drop, and it'll bring over a Finder window here. And I'm navigated to my footage. I'll just select the first frame, Command A, and then drag this into the Sources window. And now you can see that my footage is loaded in. If I double click on the footage in the Sources window, you can see it in the viewer and I can play it back, but I can't work on the files yet until I create a session. So let's do that. So there are several ways to create a session and you always want to make sure you are selected on the footage when you do that. So I'm selected on the footage, I'm going to go to Session, New Session, or Command N, or click on the icon here in the Sources window that says New Session. It looks like a little node tree, and then we'll get the New Session pop up there. We'll cancel that, or we can also just do what the instructions say, drag and drop a source from the Sources view to create a new session. And let's just do that. I'll drag it over, and here you see we have our dialog box. The clip settings are automatically imported into the session settings, and template options are where nodes are automatically added depending on the selection. With the paint selection, both paint and roto nodes will be added with the data ports connected, as this is a common workflow for paint projects. The next are the workspace options. I will be working in the streamlined option as it compacts all the windows I need for paint work into one tidy screen space. And then I also like to iterate and name my sessions since my workflow typically includes multiple sessions inside a Silhouette project file. I tend to separate tasks if they need a separate render. And so I just find it helps me remain organized and keep my output nodes correct. Our session is created and now I will quickly go through the various windows in this setup. The Sources window is where all of your sources will be located and there are some viewing options here on the bottom right. There's a combination of list view, with or without thumbnails, or just a thumbnail. And if I click on a source, then over here in the Object List tab, it will show you where you can see the path to your footage. This is good to know in case you need to re-import files or replace your footage at any point. Then also in the streamlined workspace, the different windows will be nested here with different tabs depending on what node and tool you are selected on. And the windows can be undocked and redocked to different locations in the workspace. Just click this icon here and then that will undock it. And then you can redock it back in wherever you want. Also in the nodes window here, you can see all the different groups of nodes for Silhouette. And if you want to add a favorite, which is over here in my group, this is where all my favorite nodes are, just simply find the one that you want to add. I'm going to search for the InPaint node. I'll select it and then I'll just star that. And then when I go back to all the node view lists, I can see that if I go to my favorites, that I now have in paint. Next to the nodes window here, we have the paint window, which we will be spending a lot more time here later. And then we have the timeline window, which shows the length of our clip. So down here in the lower right, you can see there's some information about how many frames we have loaded in and how much memory we've used and that our files are 8 bits. So what I'm going to do is double click this and it's going to clear the cache. You can see that. Now there's no memory being used and I'm going to press play. You can see that automatically it went to 10, and that's because we have a preload of 10 frames set in the preferences. But we could load up to 1,449 frames of a clip of this length. So we'll just press play. And these are the normal timeline controls and playback controls that you have in most programs. You can see we have first frame, last frame, the current frame we're on. This is the number of frames in our clip, the duration. And here you can see that our FPS for the clip is that number, 23.9. It's about 24 frames per second. But just note that that is not the playback speed. It's just the FPS for the clip. And here we have the frame step. So if we just wanted to look at every 5 frames, you can just click that. And then now we're just stepping through and we'll just reset it back to 1. And one more thing, another way to purge the cache is to go to session, purge RAM cache. And now you can see we're back to 0 except for it preloads the 10 frames that we have set in preferences. So next up here in the trees window, you can see we have our node tree here. And if I click on the different nodes, you can see that the windows below are changing as well. So just depending on which node you are selected on, you will get a different window configuration. Okay, let's take a look at the trees window itself. So here we have our node tree here. We have a little search area down here, and that is the show overview icon here. I can click it off and on. Here I have the list of our sessions, and we just have 1 right now. This icon is for expression links. This icon is to clean up our tree. If somehow things got really messy, you can just click that icon and it'll clean it up for you. And this icon is for to extract a node. So if I don't want to use a node in the tree at all, I can just select it and click E. And now it's not part of my tree. I'll just put that back in. And then here is to toggle the enable state, which is either enable or disable. So if I, again, select it on the roto node and I click this little lightning icon, you can see that now it's disabled. Or I can just use the hotkey D and toggle that on and off. And going on down the line, you can see we have this icon here, which is to load a node, because you can export and load nodes into Silhouette projects, except for the paint node. And then this is the save nodes. And then this icon here is to add a node. And there are actually several ways to add nodes in Silhouette. First way, you can just click the icon and then type in a node here. We can just type in color. And then you can see we have a color node. Or I can click tab and type color. Let's delete that. And then another way is to go to the nodes window down here, and I can just double click on a node here. I'll just double click on InPaint, and it will be placed inside the trees window. And of course, the last way to bring in a node is just to drag and drop. And the last icon up here is for the trees preferences. I'll click that and we'll specifically bring up the trees section here. So I typically don't change a lot for the top area here, and this trees area down below is where you can make some changes to change the look and the function of your trees in the trees window. So I've changed my background color, my connection colors are a different color, and I've also changed the connection line type. So now I'm set to curve. If I want straight, you can just set that to straight, click apply, and now you can see that my connection lines are straight. But I'm going to put them back to curved. And there's a couple other options here you can change, but I usually leave the rest at the default. And you can just click OK, and that closes the preferences. The last part of this class is just a quick run through of the icons on the top of the viewer. So over here on the upper left, we have the node selector. So depending on which node you are selected on in the trees window, that will change. And then here we have the plus icon for additional viewers. If you click that, you get a different viewer and you can select which node that it is going to be looking at, and you can just nest that in. But we'll just close that for here. And then we have the output pull down. We have the view modes here. And so each icon or each node will have a different set of viewing modes. And this pull down here is for how the viewer will update. And I always keep it on drag because that's an immediate update. And here we have the proxy pull down if you want to look at different proxies, but always keep this 1-to-1 for paint projects. And then here we have the icons on the right, and I'm only going to spend time on the ones that we're going to spend time on in class. So here we have the snapshot icon here. So if you want to compare a different frame, you can just go to a different frame, and now you can select the different view modes, either toggle the snapshot side by side, vertical or horizontal. And we just click that off to turn off the toggling. And then we have the display options here. So if I click that, then we don't see any of the display options on top of the viewer, but I usually leave this on because I'm constantly editing the gain and the gamma. So these controls here change the brightness and the color and the gamma, but it's a non-destructive change. And so if I want to see something when I'm painting and I want to just maybe zoom in and focus on something with the color here, I can just change the slider here with the gamma. If I want to make a more incremental change, I can hold down the control command key and slide it left or right. And then just to reset, you can just click the little button here, which is the reset icon. And then while we are right here, we can also just click this, and this will bring up the viewer preferences. And if you want to change any of these items in here, you can just go ahead and do so. But I leave them mostly to the default. There's a few things I might change for Roto in here, but not so much for paint. And as we go down the line here, you can see this icon here is for the ROI. This is a region of interest. This is for when you want to make a temporary crop when you're working on your frames. And we'll go over that more later. And then we have the surface tool here, and that is helpful for some tracking and painting and comping options. We have the magnifier here. So if I am in the paint node here and I click on the magnifier here, I should get a little icon down here in the lower right. Let's just try that again. We'll click on another icon and go back to the magnifier. And there it goes. I have to be selected on a tool for it to show up. So this is good for when you want to see exactly where your cursor is. And it's also good for placing point trackers when you're in the Roto node or the tracker node. And the next icon up here is the format mask. So if I hover over this, you can see the tooltip show format mask. And if you load them into the resources folder in Silhouette, you can load in different aspect ratios. And so that can be helpful if you want to know exactly which area is going to show up on your film or in your TV show. And then here we have the stabilize icon here, where we'll select on different layers to view the stabilization or to paint in the stabilize mode. And that's a really helpful tool right here. And then next to that is the rotate tool. So here it's if you want to rotate your entire viewer, the image in your viewer. So that has to be enabled. And then we'll click that, the hand for the adjust the rotate. So I don't really use this that option. I think it might be more helpful if you're rotoing and you want to see something in a different rotated view, but it's a little bit memory intensive. So I typically don't use it. So I just click that off, and to reset it, you just check that again. And so it becomes unhighlighted. And then we have the show tool overlay here. So this turns on and off any on-screen tools, including the cursor. And the hotkey for that is 0. So if I click that, you can no longer see my cursor in the viewer. And if I click that again, you can see it. So let's just make that a little more obvious. So again, if I press 0 on the keyboard, the overlay is off. But if I click the viewer, then you can see that my overlays are turned back on. So you don't actually have to click 0 again. And then to the right of the tools overlay, you have the notes icon. And this will show up if you have notes for paint or Roto or anything, they will show up here. But we don't have any notes right now, and I'll just turn that off to remove that sidebar. And we have the various preview modes, which are really helpful. And we also have the channel selectors, which can also be changed with the hotkeys. We have our alpha overlay, which is usually for Roto. And then we also have the aspect ratio correction and our zoom. So the zoom here, you can just use the pull down, or you can just use the plus minus key. There are many ways to zoom in and out of the viewer, move around, frame, and lots of different hotkeys. So the last thing I want to bring up is how to find the user guide. So we go up to the help menu here, click user guide, and this will come up, and I have it set so I can see the table of contents on the left. So if I want to see what all the different hotkeys are for the viewers or trees window or anything, I can go down here to keyboard shortcuts. I can go to the viewer, and now you can see all the different ways to navigate around the viewer. Okay, we can just close the user guide here. This is the conclusion of Class 1, a quick start intro on how to set up a project in Silhouette and become familiar with the interface. The next class is all about setting up the paint project, which will be a deeper dive in how to do the setup for a paint task. It's all in the prep. See you then.